you sent me.
Well, we're returning to some of the earlier parts of John's Gospel post-Easter. And one of the reasons for that is that we're listening to what Jesus says about the implications of his resurrection and having new life in him and how we are to live. Some bits of the Bible are very practical. And if you've read the book of James, you might know that it's one of the most practical books in the New Testament. If a poor person comes into your church, show them the best seat in the house. Don't show favoritism to rich people or respectable people. If someone is sick, anoint them with oil, pray for them. These are things that are practical. You can read it and you can do it. And some people love the practical parts of the Bible. But other bits of the Bible are very theological. They tell us what God is like. And John's Gospel is one of those very theological books. In today's passage, for example, Jesus tells us a lot about the relationship between the Father and the Son, about judgment, about resurrection. And what does he expect us to do with this theology? It doesn't have that practical immediacy that like a book of Proverbs or a book of James does. What Jesus asks us to do seems to be to listen and believe. And some people scratch their heads at these theological bits of the Bible. Either they're dry or they're confusing and complicated. What are we supposed to do with them? Maybe it's easier just to focus on the more practical bits. One thing we see, though, from this passage is that theology that challenges your beliefs is not boring, not if you've really understood it. The Jewish leaders were upset. They were challenging Jesus because of the theology he was teaching, or at least what he was implying by the things he did and said. The lead up to this is Jesus healing a lame man on the Sabbath, and they saw this as work which wasn't allowed on the Sabbath, so they took him to task. But then really it was his answer about healing that man that got them really upset, because he said, "My Father is always at work to this very day, and I too am working." Now, what's the problem with that? We talk about God as our Father all the time, but that wasn't at all the normal way to speak about God at the time. It was way too casual. No deference to God, no distinction, no reverence. As John tells us, they understood him to be making himself equal with God. And so Jesus gave them a theological answer to their theological question. And a lot of his answer includes similarities between the Son and the Father. For example, the Father is working and the Son too is working. Now, the rabbis at the time, even though Genesis says that on the seventh day God rested, there was a lot of discussion about theology, and the rabbis said, well, yes, God rested, but God's also continuously working, or else the world would fall apart. So it wasn't controversial for Jesus to say God is still working, but the implication was the Father is working to this day, and the Son too is working. Other similarities, he says, with his Father. The Father raises the dead and gives them life, and the Son gives life. The Father's will is that all may honour the Son just as they honour the Father. The Father has life in himself, the Son has life in himself. So Jesus is standing by his words. He is, in all these things, making himself equal with God. But he's also making himself distinct from God, because he's saying he's responsible to God. He's obedient to God. Because all those things are delegated by God to the Son. He says the Father judges no one, but has entrusted all judgment to the Son. The Father has granted the Son also to have life in himself. He's given him authority to judge because he's the Son of Man. Jesus is saying, don't think I'm trying to set myself up as equal to God and to compete with God. By myself, I can do nothing. I seek not to please myself, but him who sent me. I can only do what I see my Father doing. And that image that Stacey brought out so well, it's a beautiful image. You know, maybe Jesus even had in mind the way he learned his trade of carpentry from Joseph. Sometimes when we're talking with young kids, if you say something like, Jesus prayed to God, or Jesus went to be with God, you get the response, but Jesus is God. What do you mean Jesus did those things? And as I was preparing this, I thought this might be a good way to respond. Jesus is equal with God the Father, but he himself is God the Son, and he's been given a lot of God's work to do, work that only God can do. I don't know if that's helpful. If you have a chance to chat with any kids about it, let me know how it goes. That's Jesus' answer to the authorities. Yes, he's equal with God, but not in a competitive way, like another God. He looks to the Father and he depends on the Father completely. But still, the question, if we've accepted that and we're not feeling challenged by Jesus' theology, we're like, yeah, I believe that, okay. Well, then what do we take away from this? What does it mean for us that the Son can only do what he sees his Father doing? Well, Jesus' theology is pastoral. And in fact, if you dig deep enough, all theology is pastoral because it affects how we relate to God and how we live our lives. Something that I love about what Jesus says here is the fact that it shows us what God is like. Because if the Son does only what he sees the Father doing, and he does that completely, and we wonder, what's God's attitude to us? What's God like? The answer is, he is what Jesus is like. The particular pastoral topics that Jesus gives us here are judgment and resurrection. These are two big examples of what he calls greater works that he says the Father will show him and he will do. That is, he means greater works than what I've just done, healing the lame man. I'm going to do greater works than these, judgment and resurrection, and you will be amazed. Let's look at both of those. First, judgment. Because the Son does only what he sees his Father doing, we are judged mercifully. That example that he just given, in a way, I think Jesus is still referring back to the healing of the lame man. That was an example of how he judges people. He's healed a man in need on the Sabbath, not because the man was worthy, but freely. Jesus was pleased to give him life. And that's how we'll be judged too, with the mercy of Jesus, because the Father's delegated all judgment to him. Verse 22, the Father judges no one, but has entrusted all judgment to the Son. He's not some high and lofty judge who hands down verdicts. He himself has died for the very people that he judges. He loves us more than we can know. So it's great news that all judgment has been entrusted to the Son. But the implication of this is that Jesus uniquely deserves our worship. In fact, the reason given why he's the judge is that all may honor the Son just as they honor the Father. And in verse 23, whoever does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him. Let's think about honor for a minute. What does our government do if they want to honor the government of another country? Well, one thing they do is invite the country's ambassador to a special function, praise the country, or if our government's unhappy with another country, they might give the ambassador a dressing down. They might even, in extreme circumstances, expel the ambassador. How they treat the ambassador is how they treat the country. And how we treat Jesus or honor Jesus or worship Jesus is how we treat God. That's what makes Christianity unique from every other faith. We believe God has come in the person of Jesus to give us undeserved grace. It's not about trying to get to God ourselves. It's accepting the one in whom God has come to us. How we treat Jesus is how we treat God. And this too is good news because of Jesus' second amazing work, resurrection. Resurrection means we can cross from death to life. Verse 24, very truly I tell you, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be judged, but has crossed over from death to life. This is good news, both for people who are yearning for new life. They know that they need it, that all is not well in this life. And also for people who don't. First, people who are looking for new life. On my dad's side of the family, my ancestors lived in Prussia, and they were farming labourers. That's, by the way, kind of borders Germany and Poland. I think I need to learn more about my family history. They were farming labourers, and they were attached to an estate, but they could be sold or transferred to other landlords, to other estates, and they weren't allowed to leave their estate without the landlord's permission. They had very few privileges, and their status in life, it was little better than slaves. So in the mid-19th century, when the opportunity arose, they moved to Australia. They moved from a place of struggle and hardship to a place of life. That's what they were looking for. A bit like people who hear Jesus offer to believe and cross over from death to life. Now, if you're unsure if God is pleased with you, you don't know where you stand with God, this is good news because it's not something you have to wonder about for the future. It's not about what will happen. It's not just about what will happen at the judgment, at the end of life in heaven. Jesus says, very truly I tell you, a time has now come when the dead will hear the voice of the Son and God, and those who hear will live. If you believe in him, you have crossed over from death to life now, in the present. And this is good news for people, even if they don't think they need to cross over anywhere. Some of my ancestors went to South Australia and they settled in a valley that looked like a great spot to live. Quiet, fertile, a good location. And it was. It was a great place for several years. The problem was, periodically, that region would flood, which they found out the hard way. It wasn't livable after all. They had to move. Many people think they have no need of Jesus. But that doesn't mean they don't. A time will come when they understand that they do. My ancestors got surprised. At the end of our passage, Jesus says, don't be surprised. Verse 28, do not be amazed at this. For a time is coming when all who are in their graves will hear his voice and come out. Those who have done what is good will rise to live, and those who have done what is evil will rise to be condemned. This is talking about what's known as the general resurrection the Bible teaches about. That just as the world had a beginning created by God, just as the world has a purpose to live under God, so the world has a destination, an end. And at that end, there will be a resurrection of all people, either to eternal life or to condemnation, based, Jesus says, on whether they have done good or evil. Now, Jesus has not suddenly started preaching salvation by works here. After all, he's just said the way to cross over from death to life is to believe by hearing his word and believing God. Rather, he's preaching just what he says elsewhere. For example, he says, no good tree bears bad fruit, nor does a bad tree bear good fruit. Each tree is recognized by its own fruit. Also, what it says elsewhere in the Bible, like Ephesians 2. We have been created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared for us in advance to do. This is specific and pointed. Remember, Jesus is talking to the leaders who they didn't want him healing the man on the Sabbath. Well, he calls them and us to put aside our human Sabbath regulations, if you like, if they're getting in the way of giving life to others. That's an example of the fruit Jesus calls us to bear, the difference that it makes believing in Jesus. Healing, giving life, that is doing good. And it comes from our faith. And that's where all this theology is very practical. We can't just sit comfortably knowing, well, we've crossed over from death to life. Isn't that nice for us? We, in turn, look at what Jesus does and we imitate him. We seek to give life and love to others in every way. Because we know that the Son has been given authority both to judge and to raise the dead to life. We know he has life in himself and he's been pleased to give us that life. And it's because we know whose voice will lift us out of our own graves, along with all who believe in him and live out their belief to eternal life. Let's pray. O Lord of life, by submitting to death, you conquered the grave. By being lifted upon the cross, you draw all peoples to you. By being raised from the dead, you restore to humanity all that was lost through sin. Be with us in your risen power, that in word and deed we may proclaim the marvelous mystery of death and resurrection. For all praise is yours, now and throughout eternity.